So it's really amazing to be here today with Ramin, Ahmad, for me as the assistant director of this film, Man Push Cart, to be back in New York in an environment in some ways much like the one where we made the film, which means that we hear people working, drilling, throwing things around, to talk about Man Push Cart, a film that we made 15 years ago when we really didn't know anything. We just knew that we wanted to make this movie.
Yeah, it's great to be here. You were the assistant director, but you were 100 other jobs too on the film, because we didn't even know what an assistant director was at that time.
No, I'm so happy to see you. It's been a long time.
Likewise.
With the three amigos again, man, come on.
So Ramin, you and I met in September 2002, right after I moved to New York City. We went to a screening of Kiarostami's 10 together at the New York Film Festival.
Yeah.
That first night, we understood that we both were maniacs about film, and you started telling me about a film that at that time, if I remember correctly, you were planning, and it was called Unopened. As I remember it, right away you said, would you help me? And I was like, yeah, of course. I mean, I liked you and I read the script and it seemed fascinating, but we had no idea. At one point we talked like, could we make this in Super 8? What were you imagining? Like, how did you think this film could exist?
I mean, I had no idea. I had no formal training in filmmaking. I had studied film theory. When it came time to start to get the thing together, I had to have an attorney. I had to have contracts, like for cast, crew, locations. So I went to the Barnes & Noble at Union Square and bought a book. I think it was called, like, Contracts for Film and Television by Mark Lidowick or something like that. And I went home and I transcribed the contracts that seemed relevant to our movie into my laptop. And that was the attorney for the movie. I had no conception what it meant to make a movie. I'd gone to Iran to try to make a feature film there, and 9/11 happened, and the financing for that fell apart. And I was thinking about who were Middle Eastern, Afghan, different kind of characters that I knew that lived in New York, and I thought about pushcart vendors. And I thought that could be a good idea for a film. I started to spend a lot of time meeting pushcart vendors all over Manhattan. They were Afghans, Egyptians, Pakistani, Bangladeshi. I came to realize a lot of them lived in Midwood, Brooklyn. Now, this was right after 9/11, so it was not an easy time to be called Ahmad Razvi or Ramin Bahrani or to be a brown guy in New York City. And in Midwood, the neighborhood was getting pretty hard hit. So I went out there as a person who isn't from that community. It's not easy to start to talk to people. And I speak Persian, but I don't speak Urdu. After roaming around for a while, I stopped in a pastry shop just to get a tea and a bite to eat. And Ahmad Razvi was the man who served me the tea and pastry. It was his family's restaurant. They owned a lot of different businesses there in the neighborhood. And he was friendly. He opened up and we just started a dialogue.
Mm-hmm. Ahmad, do you remember what you thought of Ramin when you first met him and as you got to know him? Like,
I remember everything in detail. How we met, and I remember I was coming out of the basement picking up some supplies out of the restaurant, and I see him on the counter, and then he ordered some food, and we just started talking. And then, you know, I was curious about our neighborhood and living in Midwood for almost 20 years. You know, I was very familiar, and then also we were very well connected with the community. My father is the founder of certain organizations and certain days and for like Pakistani Day parades and so forth. At that same time, we heard about all these stories of people being arrested just because, like Ramin said, you know, his name is Ahmed or Ramin or Mustafa or something, or Muhammad. You know, the officials, police, INS, FBI would come and raid at these people's houses. At the same time, they would take like the breadwinner, which is usually the male, you know. And as soon as you take them away, you're just destroying the family. At one point, the community, it started to disappear. You would see normally people wearing like their own traditional clothes, going to the mosque or going to the store or getting some food. And all of a sudden, it's just desolate. There's no one walking or moving or anything because people were afraid. So my father's like, hey man, we gotta do something. So we opened up an organization called COPO, Council of People's Organization, where we became a liaison or a middleman from our community to the government agencies, from you know, FBI to INS, to the local police, and we started to voice our concerns and what's happening to us, being targeted and so forth, and we became like this channel that they can talk through. When Ramin and I met, he was interested about our community, interested in pushcart vendor, and I knew a few. I had a little experience in it as well. We became friends immediately. We started talking, we started hanging out a lot. I'm thinking that, you know, he likes my food in my restaurant, so he keeps on coming, but no. Good year and a half, year and a half, back and forth.
Yeah.
And then one day, he's like, I want to make this film and I want you to be the lead. And I was like, okay.
I mean, what was interesting in meeting Ahmad was there was a charisma to him. He seemed photogenic, and in talking to him, I learned all the things that he's describing now, which is there was a social aspect to him. He was engaged in the community. He had knowledge. I came to learn over time he had done work as a pushcart vendor a long time ago, so he had experience doing this job. He had done construction work. He had run businesses. He had started businesses. He had this nonprofit, so he was kind of, in his own way, a Renaissance man. This guy could be a key to me in terms of getting into the community and learning more. My intention was to work with people who had never had acting experience for the most part. The more time we spent together, the more I would learn about his life, his stories, things that were personal to him or his community.
Right.
And all those elements started to come into the script. I don't know, a fourth of the movie is Ahmad alone. And a large part of the movie was made with just me, you, Ahmad, and Michael Simmons, the cinematographer.
He's like the fourth person that kind of...
Yeah, he was a fourth person of what we called the A-team, which were the people crazy enough to shoot on the days off, and when the crew went home, to shoot like 4 more hours to the point of exhaustion.
Yeah, we were doing 16, 18 hours days.
Yeah. He was a key part of the movie in terms of his talent and kind of as crazy as us to make a movie with no money. There wasn't any money, and I didn't know anybody. And it's not easy to find money for a movie that has no famous people in it. With at that time, being diverse wasn't a cool thing. It wasn't an asset. And it's not a commercial movie. It took 2 years to raise, I think, ultimately $40,000. Pradeep Ghosh and Nick Bentley were the two producing partners. They were my classmates from college. And Pradeep, he didn't have a credit card. He accepted to get a credit card and put $20,000 on a credit card under the understanding that when we made the movie, we would raise more money, pay him first, and then find more money to somehow finish the film. The total movie cost, I think, $80,000. The crew was tiny, like I think it was 10 people. And, you know, Ahmad helped in so many ways. And sometimes we would ask Ahmad to also unload and load things from our little cube van or truck. We had nothing really, no equipment. You know, sometimes he was legitimately helping because he's a nice guy and community-oriented, didn't know that an actor was not really supposed to load equipment. And other times, I would just ask him to do it to exhaust him, which matched the character.
I think what has to be addressed if we're going to talk about your performance, Ahmad, is the fact that you did this incredibly athletic thing of pulling a pushcart down Lexington Avenue and other streets in the middle of traffic. Doing it was not that fun, if I remember correctly.
Not at all, man. That was one of the most toughest physical work I had to do.
That was the biggest expense of the movie, was the car. The car was $5,000.
Tell us about the cart, then. How did we get the cart?
Well, I had befriended this guy in Queens who had the garage. He's in the movie.
Yeah.
He's in that scene when you tell him I've lost the cart.
Oh, behind the desk.
Behind the desk.
In the garage, yes.
And his main partner was to the left. So he arranged for us to buy that cart because we couldn't rent it, really.
Did you check the whole place? No, I checked this place and everything. I checked the corners. I checked everywhere, man.
The intention was to make the movie and then turn around and sell it. And that is what we did, except that there was an accident, of course.
Right off Lexington Avenue, like around 50th Street.
Yeah. It was a downhill and a little bit too fast as I was pushing it, and somehow I tripped. And that was a scary scene. I mean, on this side, it's the cart that's gonna, you know, run me down. Or on the other side, it's this yellow cab that's just flying right by me.
I remember it as an 18-wheeler, honestly.
I remember.
Or a bus.
Dude, as I'm falling, I'm literally, my life did flash by me.
Wow.
And it happened such in slow motion. I was like, shit, what are we gonna do if we lose this cart? It's gonna topple, it's gonna break, and we're done. We still had other shoots that we had to do.
Yeah.
So I kept on thinking that I gotta save this cart. So I pulled it, and literally, I don't know where I got the strength from, and I pulled it, and somehow I saw all in the end Michael Simmons, and everybody is just, you know, in shock, but I'm not looking at anything except for the camera. But it's very far from me.
Very far.
So I was like, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm just gonna keep on pulling this, put it back on track, or the angle that it's supposed to be, that's where I was pushing it to, and just keep on going. And as soon as I passed Michael Simmons, I just released the cart, and I just literally fell down. And then to Ramin, I was like, Ramin, please tell me you got that shot. Please tell me you got that shot. He goes, oh, I got it. I said, okay, great, that's it. And I just passed on the floor.
There was one other thing you said after that.
Yeah.
You said, I think, F you, and I will never push this card again. I had to talk to convince you to do it again for another scene. I don't blame you, really, but you didn't talk to me for 3 days after that. Then we talked again.
I was so upset.
We had the energy and idealism, and if you want to call it naivete, of youth. I mean, I remember it was a very long shot. You're going down Lexington Avenue at night, and I was following you on the sidewalk, yelling encouragement at you. Stuff like, it's so great, Ahmad. This movie's gonna make history. Like, and I really believed it.
All right, can I have a coffee and a bagel, please? I'll just take a tea this morning, I'm in a hurry. Okay?
Hey, you.
Hey, what's up?
When we got into casting, it was challenging because we needed to get all these people to be customers at the pushcart at night, on rainy mornings. I don't think we were paying, or if we were paying, maybe it was $50 and a free coffee. And so we had to find these people, and we were at the Pit doing auditions,
yeah.
Right?
Ali Reza Farinakian is a good friend, an Iranian-American improv writer, comic, actor. He owns a set of theaters.
I can't promise you anything, but I'll do whatever I can to help. It wasn't that long ago when I was starting out in the city myself.
Okay.
Hey, man.
He was another huge help to the movie. In terms of talent and letting us use his space, rehearsal space, to audition.
Cheers.
You know, to be clear, it was a non-SAG, non-union movie.
Right.
You know, we had all the permits from the mayor's office to shoot on streets, but it was a totally no-budget movie. Anyone who's done, quote, diverse casting knows it's not always easy. It's hard to find the talent. They haven't been encouraged to do it, or their cultural background doesn't compute with the family, like, especially if you're an immigrant, you know, the family's like, I sacrificed everything to come here. You're gonna do acting, movie making, what's that? So it's mainly engineer, doctor, more traditional work. So the casting was difficult. A lot of times there's just real people who wander into the frame, and Ahmad is selling things to people who don't know they're being filmed.
Born very DVDs. Improv.
How much?
It's $8,
2 for $15.
$8, no. Come on, $2 for $15.
Yeah, I get $4 in the Bronx.
$4?
Yeah.
Come on. I had a lot of friends in there, you know, Duke and...
Your brother as well. Your brother is the guy who pulls up behind the pushcart in the car. It's an amazing scene.
Thanks, man. How you been?
It's okay. How's everything?
Not good, man. The city's driving me nuts. The company got me working late nights. I can't get any sleep.
All his dialogue was lifted from another pushcart vendor I had spent time
with. Yes, I remember.
Have you seen Reza lately?
No.
No? Man, I hear he's got it sweet. He's up in Albany, he's working in Dunkin' Donuts. That's the life.
The concept that I think before the financial crisis was hard for white people to understand was that these kind of scrappy dollar a day, dollar an hour jobs that immigrants had, the more I looked around, it just seemed like that's just the way the country was going. Once the financial crisis hit, I think more people started to realize that movies like Man Pushcart were not just about financially, let's say in terms of capitalism, weren't just about immigrants, but it was about the country at large. But now I think once the financial crisis hit, and even more so now in this pandemic, we're realizing that capitalism, the way we have come to understand in the last 30, 40 years, has been basically making it very difficult to live. So in that scene with your brother, the idea that leaving the push cart to go to Albany and work in a Dunkin' Donuts is like winning the lottery. You know,
right,
that would be like a phenomenal job.
Being that said, and doing so many different odd jobs and dealing with community, dealing with public, I think it was easy for me to adapt into acting and being this character.
I feel one of the things that helped was we were so comfortable with each other. And me, you, Mike Simmons, and Nicholas, we also did a lot of shooting on handy cams. Do you remember that?
Yes, absolutely. Right.
Because I had made some short films on my own, but didn't have the training. And in order to be like really prepared, I thought we should go to the locations and shoot with a handy cam to try to understand how we're going to make the movie and where would we put the camera. So I think a lot that I think really helped, because by the time we made the movie for real, you were so
used to it,
comfortable with it.
Yeah.
Suddenly it's just happening.
Going to these pushcart vendors' streets, their locations, like 12, 1, 2 a.m., really late, and just looking at them and seeing what's going on. How they're opening the bags, how they're putting the tea bags underneath the cup, all these things. You're right, we got used to it.
This helped, in a way, the mixture between what feels like documentary, or in some cases is documentary, when you're interacting with people who don't know they're on camera.
Exactly.
Going back to one of the things you were talking about earlier in terms of your neighborhood, people getting taken off the streets or being accosted, even in the shooting of the movie, we were getting hassled. I remember we were shooting one night at like 2 a.m. I think he was an Italian immigrant. I think he was a worker in one of the buildings, like maintenance.
Yes.
So he's coming home from his own labor job. And he walked by us and he said, what are you doing here? Funding a bin Laden training camp?
Yes.
And I thought, I guess I should let this go, but I was so angry about it. I followed him and I just said, what did you just say? To his credit, honestly, I think he immediately knew it was not the right thing to say. Mm. And I said, well, why did you say that? And he's like, I don't know. But that wasn't the only one. No. It happened, I think, 3-4 times. We were accosted that time. You were walking into a subway with a propane tank, right?
Yes, yes.
And there were guys out there selling counterfeit Gucci bags.
Yes.
And like counterfeit Rolex watches on the side of the street.
On Lexington 52, the FBI building, which has no windows.
Yes. Yes. And that gas tank was another one of these burdens you carry in the movie.
Right.
They were like, what are you guys doing? Who are you? You terrorists are going in there with this gas tank. You can't. I said, we're shooting a movie. No, you can't shoot a movie here. I said, no, I can't. I have a permit. Let me see your permit. I said, I don't actually have to show you the permit unless you're the authority of this building, and as I understand, you're selling some counterfeit stuff here. Well, I don't have to show you a permit. And he said, no, you're a terrorist, and we're going to call the FBI. I said, go ahead. Yeah. Sure enough, I got a call from the FBI. Yeah. I had borrowed my dad's Toyota Camry for the shoot, and yeah, sure enough, he got the license plate number when we drove away.
Yeah.
So the FBI kept calling my dad. He was like, you got to call my son. And so then they called. He said who he was, and that he was from the FBI task force, and wanted to know if I knew why he was calling. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we had a conversation, and there was nothing to worry about, but I did let him know that we had high-definition footage of two guys selling counterfeit Gucci bags, should the FBI find that worthy of their time.
So we survived this shoot, and then Ramin
you decided to edit the film yourself.
And there was no money. Nick Bentley was a good friend, a classmate from college, and was one of the producers, and was nice enough at this point of editing to let me live rent-free because I had no money. I didn't have a job. I had no idea how to use Final Cut Pro. I called my brother, and he said that he had subscribed to a website called Mandy.com, I think, and he had learned how to make websites. And he looked and he said, there's a tutorial here for Final Cut Pro, and I haven't canceled my subscription. You could watch it. So I watched it a few times that weekend and then just started editing. And it was a whole process of trying to edit long takes. We would shoot a scene with Ahmed and the Muhammad character in an apartment that were like 5 minutes long with no coverage and no cutting. When I got to the editor room, I was like, wow, these scenes are terrible. Like, who wrote this? But in that 5 minutes, there was like 1 minute that I wanted, and it was a struggle to try to figure out how to cut into moving masters, and yeah, it was a long process of learning how to edit a movie.
Tell me, if I ever needed help, I could come to you.
And I have helped you.
So, Muhammad, please,
I have to work in the morning.
You promised me you would help me out.
Take your goddamn pushcart and your fucking problems, get the hell out of here.
Once it was finished, then it had to find its audience, and that turned out to take a while, and you nearly gave up, right? Tell us about when it finally did get into a festival.
At that time, I had nowhere to live. Nick Bentley had moved. I was living in Michael Simmons' apartment. He had gone to Brazil, so I was finishing the film there. There was just enough money to mail. There was no links at that time, so you had to mail a DVD to film festivals through FedEx, which was really expensive. I could send it to maybe 7 or 8 festivals. I remember a handful of them: Venice, Locarno, San Sebastian. I sent it to the Hamptons, which at that time, it was a solid festival, but maybe not as prestigious as it is now. And the first response I got was Hamptons, and they said no. And I remember being so devastated because I thought it was a kind of New York in a way. I remember thinking that was that. I don't know anyone. There's no connections to anyone. So I packed up the car to drive back to North Carolina to go to stay with my brother and my parents and try to figure out what I would do with my life, go back to school, grad school, or something like that. And I was gonna check my email one last time before getting in the car to leave. And I couldn't believe it was an email from Venice that the film had been accepted. And I did 30 push-ups, which I didn't think I could do. I didn't even know how I did it. I was just so excited.
To me, that was just a school, how to enhance your abilities, your acting and production, direction and lighting and camera and everything. I think that was like the best education that I, you know, got throughout my life.
What did you take from Man Push Cart that carried forward into your work to the present day?
Not to wait for somebody to tell you yes. Well, my first 3 films could have been made by any film student, any young filmmaker, just through forces of sheer will and finding collaborators and friends and actors and partners that would help you make them. We never waited for the film industry to say, yes, we would allow you to make this movie. Because it's so hard to get a film made, I came to understand then, and I still do the same thing now, you just have to march forward as if the movie's gonna happen. And eventually, if you keep going on that train, people start to get on with you. You just have to go forward. It appears that the door is locked, and you think it's locked, but the key is in your hand. You just got to open the door and go.